how you like me meow. Ted Cruz and John Kasich are declaring a truce to try and stop the Trump train, and it has unleashed the unholy Donald.
Now you look at Kasich. I don't think he knows where. You know, did you see him? He has a news conference all the time when he's eating. I have never seen a human being eat in such a disgusting fashion. This guy takes a pancake and he's shoving it in his mouth. It's disgusting.
Oh, a disgusting pancake shover can't be president. So much for being presidential. Let's bring in the party panel to sort it all out tonight. It's Catherine Timpf, National Review reporter and correspondent on the Greg Gutfeld Show. She's joined tonight by the immaculate beard. It's comedian Joe DeVito. And making his triumphant return tonight, it's Rick Unger, senior political contributor at Forbes and host of Steel and Unger on SiriusXM. Welcome, everybody. Welcome back, Rick.
Good to be back.
So nice to have you
here. I'm thrilled.
Oh, my gosh. We have a lot to talk about. Welcome, everybody.
Yay.
Yay. We're all on the air together again. Let's hold hands. So Trump has another strategy that is a gift given to him by Cruz and Kasich, and that is these guys working together to try and bring him down. It only builds him up, doesn't it?
Well, I'll tell you what, the strategy's working. He managed to get the word collude into one sentence about 17 times.
Yeah.
That's doing something, man. Look, this whole thing's broken.
That's a big word for the poorly educated.
Big word. It's a big word.
Like pancake.
Yeah, like pancake. Yeah.
Flapjack.
Yeah.
But it's not working already. The first one goes out today. Kasich goes, what? What? What's the big deal? There's nothing here. Go ahead. Vote for me in Indiana. And then Cruz goes out there and says, I'm so pleased to announce that Governor Kasich has ceded the state of Indiana to me. Doesn't bother mentioning the other part of the deal. So I'd say the deal lasted about 4 hours.
Now, the deal's pretty much, I mean, these guys have massive egos. They are so convinced they have a better chance than Donald Trump. They both think they're going to be the nominee and the next president. And, you know, Kasich is one of the last two people in the race who actually has better favorable numbers than any of them.
But he eats so poorly.
Oh, he did, with the pancake and the choking.
Yeah.
But, Joe, I mean, if they're going to get together to try and tackle Trump, shouldn't they have done this months ago?
Well, this goes to show, how do you turn an arrogant billionaire into a sympathetic figure? Well, how about a little behind-the-scenes wheeling and dealing like that? And that is right. That shows you exactly why Trump is so popular, because people are looking at the system and saying, wait a minute, our votes don't count. There's all this shenanigans going on behind the scenes. Although, I'll say this, don't adjust the color on your TV set. Trump is actually becoming more and more like the golden calf every time they show him. He's physically turning into gold. Have you noticed it?
Yeah.
His skin and hair are becoming one shining.
Yeah,
as his power builds.
He's also got tight pants.
If he loses, he can do Pantene commercials.
He can.
God, lovely.
Frightening.
Yeah. All right, but it does tank Kasich's VP shot. Because, you know, Donald has really, he's still been pretty gentle on Kasich this whole time. A few barbs here and there. So everyone thought, you know, well, he won Ohio so impressively. Obviously, Trump's going to pick him. He's part of the establishment. That's what he needs to legitimize himself for the party. That's done, isn't it?
Absolutely, but I guess if he's doing this, he didn't want that anyway. They so clearly, if the goal was to stop Trump, should have done this a long time ago.
Exactly.
But they were saying no, no, no. So now that they are doing it, they're saying they're really scared. It doesn't look like a strategic move as much as it looks like a last-ditch move. Like,
exactly,
oh, wow,
right.
We're really scared now. We've been hearing forever that we should be doing this, but now we are. Something's changed. What's changed is that they really think they're in trouble.
No, it's desperation.
Are.
Yeah, no, mm-hmm. this literally is the Hail Mary. It's the very last play of the game because they know that their backs are against the wall. They are losing, but it's so funny because they both think they'll win. Yeah. If they could just keep them from the 1237, they're both happening. Convinced they'll be the nominee.
The Stop Trump movement, I actually got the numbers of what everybody's spending over the next few primaries. They haven't spent a cent. They're not spending anything. Club for Growth has $1 million. They're fine. Going to spend in Indiana. It's like it's a hashtag now. That's all Stop Trump is.
Well, never Trump.
There's nothing there.
I wish they would buy a bunch of melons.
Now, if they're able to actually pull this off, do they think people are just going to forget it? And do they think Donald Trump's going to quietly go, well, I guess you guys got me.
Yeah, good
He's
job,
not
going to
try and completely ruin
no,
the election.
No, no one has any foresight. The ego's too big for that. All right, a new George Washington University battleground poll has a Republican frontrunner. Maybe you've heard of him. Donald J. Trump rapidly gaining on Democratic frontrunner Hillary Rodham Clinton in a hypothetical head-to-head matchup. The former Secretary of State's got 46%. Mr. Trump at 43%. This is a very big development in the race because Trump has been saying for some time, I'm really close, I'm really close, I'm gaining on her. Sometimes these national polls don't mean anything. Do you put any stock in this?
Well, it's a contest to see who could have the highest unfavorability ratings. It would be those two.
Yeah.
They were actually mentioning how Kasich has the best unfavorability score of only 20, because no one cares. He also leads in the duh and the who's that guy categories.
Right.
He doesn't make any difference.
He's Jim Gilmore.
What are we doing? He's not doing very well, but he has the lowest or the highest favorability ratings. That's because, you know, you have to know enough about somebody to hate them.
Right. Yeah. Generally. Oh, that's a really good point.
Care.
Yeah. Well said.
It's irrelevant.
All right. So, Rick, are the processes on both sides so opaque and rigged that the American public is going to get hosed no matter what?
Well, if you do think that they are, and I've seen the arguments on both sides, then it's no different than it's been for as long as I can remember.
Yeah.
And I graduated high school with Lincoln.
That's a really good point. It's not different. And people are making
different.
A big deal this year.
It used to be worse.
The candidates are making a big deal about
it. That's just it. We've tuned into process, which is kind of interesting. But it is, in fact, it's better.
Yeah.
Up until the 70s, people had nothing to say about candidates. It was all the guy smoking cigars in the back room. That was for real.
And people accepted that.
And people accepted it. You voted for whoever they wanted you to vote for, one or the other. So now it's better, and people are going crazy. And I guess it's kind of interesting. Maybe we're heading towards a national primary. Maybe we're not, because when you do a national primary, television stations all over America lose a fortune.
Mm-hmm.
So, but it's kind of fun to see them tune into the process.
Well, it certainly is something, and the process is not over. Although it looks like we have these two established front runners, there's still a lot of crazy left in the race.
Sure.
God. All right, and I will be joining you tomorrow night for FBN's live coverage of Super Tuesday 3.
People are people, so why should it be?
I'm still dancing to it. Very good.
Hey, welcome back. Over the weekend, billionaire Charles Koch, you've heard of him. He's the devil incarnate. He leans libertarian, and he made a very surprising admission. Hillary Clinton, he said, might actually make the better president out of the leading candidates. Wait, what? Take a look.
So is it possible another Clinton could be better than another Republican?
It's possible.
You couldn't see yourself supporting Hillary Clinton, could you?
Well, we would have to believe her actions would be quite different than her rhetoric.
Now, this comes only days after George Clooney painted the Koch brothers with the standard liberal brush of plutocrats looking to buy elections for purely selfish reasons.
I think there is a difference between the Koch brothers and us. The Koch brothers would profit if they get their way. And that's what, we have there's no profit for us in this.
Oh, George, Jorge, how dare you? The party panel is back. Kathryn Timpf, Joe DeVito, and Rick Unger. So I'm going to start with you, Kat. The Kochs constantly demonized by the left, as though there are no profit-seeking billionaires in the Democratic Party. Do you think that this is a shrewd move by Charles Koch to tank Hillary because she's so embarrassed that he's kind of endorsing
she's
her?
She's so embarrassed. If it is, it's working, because I love that she came out to say no. No, no, no. But when the KKK Grand Dragon came out to endorse her, she said nothing.
So she did not disavow
that one.
That was Trump who came out to endorse
her. No. Exactly. Also, another KKK official endorsed Hillary, saying that she secretly believes in their agenda. Happened in March.
Everybody
Nobody says anything about it due to the liberal media.
Mm.
But that was what she's more concerned about. Oh, the Koch brother. No. Yeah.
No.
No, not that.
No,
fine, but not a successful billionaire.
All right. So either he's totally messing with her, or he really, really wants to be liked.
Listen to what he said. He said, yeah, maybe we can support her if she changed every single thing that she says.
Yeah.
Well, that's
if she became a libertarian, I'd support her.
Yeah, if she
would
became
never
Koch, so I didn't really take that as a huge vote of confidence.
Well,
the
it's certainly not an investment in a Republican candidate. They pledged
like
$1 billion. If you remember, the Kochs met with Scott Walker, Marco Rubio, Rand Paul.
But they never pledged anything to those guys. Here's what people don't get about the Kochs. The Kochs have huge influence in state races.
Yeah.
That's where they invest their their money, and they've been hugely successful.
Much more so than Tom Steyer, who picked a bunch of dinged up donkeys.
They don't invest big in national elections,
yeah.
And they sure aren't going to this year because they don't like anybody on either side.
All right, is Hillary Clinton the best choice for libertarians, or is Charles Koch suffering the first signs of a debilitating brain disease?
I think this is why you never answer hypothetical questions, because you have nothing to gain from it. I mean, like Rick said, if Hillary Clinton was a completely different person, yeah. Would you have a different opinion on her?
Yeah.
And the best you can say is, yeah, I guess. But she did go out of her way to say she tweeted that she didn't want the support of someone who, I think she said, makes it harder for people to vote. Of course, Democrats always relying on the deceased people to vote
yeah.
for them. But I don't see her Clinton
only
Foundation.
In Chicago.
Well, also she accepts money, they accepted money for the Clinton Foundation from the Gulf state kingdoms, where women have only recently been allowed to vote, and
yeah.
they treat their minorities terribly. So I don't see the Clinton Foundation
sending us checks back. No, I think I'd rather take money from brothers who've donated already over $1 billion to causes like, you know, the American Natural History Museum in New York City.
Well, they're on the right side. I don't have any questions
yeah,
about
what
that.
Do you have against the museum?
Yeah, and cancer research.
The pin, like poke
well, I'll tell you what I have said to David Koch, mm-hmm. who, you know, I disagree with him virtually about what time it is.
Yeah.
But I told him I do appreciate everything he's done for my city.
Yeah.
And he's done a great deal. And you can't just throw that out.
No, you can't. But Democrats would like to for political convenience, which
don't.
Is incredibly hypocritical. That's why I appreciate you, Rick Unger.
Yeah.
Yes. All right, coming up, MTV. Good, Back to the Future, bro. Are they bringing music back? Perhaps their scientists will decipher the latest Beyonce video. First up, Deirdre Bolton shows us the delegate tightrope act. Republican candidates are having to walk. Everything comes down to Indiana. You'll see why we moved to the big board. That's coming up next. Stay here. Just jamming a little bit with my friends. We're all wearing glasses. Last year, the NFL suspended Tom Brady for 4 games due to his alleged role in the Deflategate scandal. He successfully reversed that decision in court, but now a federal appeals court has overturned that decision, reinstating the 4-game ban. The party panel is back to chew that one over like Giselle's discarded gum. It's Catherine Timp, Joe DeVito, and Rick Unger. All right, so Rick, explain the psychology here, because I want to spike the football in his face. I'm so delighted by this.
It's
Tom Brady's face.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's just it. I mean, this whole thing seems to be decided based on who you like and who you don't. I read what the court had to say.
Yes.
It could have gone either way, as could the district court. It all comes down to whether or not the collective bargaining agreement gives the commissioner that wide of a berth.
The court said it did. The court said specifically about collective bargaining that he acted within.
But there was a dissent,
okay.
and the dissent is what was at the heart of the district
court case.
Clarence
Thomas, right?
Always. Now that Scalia is gone, he owns the dissent.
That's right. It's a good chair.
So it's whether or not there was an alternate punishment mm-hmm. that could have been handed out, and he didn't.
Yeah.
The commissioner didn't, and that is really what caused a lot of trouble. This was very heavy.
I know. I can just hear the mass holes now sort of piping up. Okay, but how big of an impact does this have on the season? I mean, 4 games.
4 games.
That's pretty substantial.
Well, I looked at the schedule. I don't know how well their backup, I believe the name is Janine Garofalo, was the name of the quarterback.
Jimmy Garoppolo.
Something like that.
He's my favorite quarterback in the league.
I'd say 3 of the 4 games
are
pretty winnable.
Who they got?
They've got, I think, Buffalo, Houston,
yes.
And
did I see Arizona?
Arizona's the tough one.
Arizona,
but the good news is they come back against the Browns. That is as close as you can come to a game. It's almost like physical therapy
yeah.
for someone. You could forget coming off a suspension. You could be coming out of a coma and pushing against the Browns,
or still be in the coma.
Still be in the coma. Well, that's
Johnny
Manziel's role.
No,
yeah.
Thank God
bless America for that.
Thank God.
And for small miracles, would you have suspended him, Kat?
Yeah.
That's right. Girl.
I don't care about football. I'm trying. I really want to because I want to fit in and be invited to stuff where there's football.
Sure.
And
nachos.
Stuff in general, you know. But I think he did it. He
yeah.
clearly did it.
He clearly did it.
It's just he's like the popular kid that gets away with everything. And I don't like those kind of people.
No, exactly. He's the handsome man with the dimple.
Yeah.
Tom Brady's never been ugly.
Yeah, exactly. I had a mullet.
No, he
a
was
while.
Ugly. He was the quarterback for Michigan. This is the biggest problem.
All right. Well,
you should go to hell for that.
Has announced a new line of programming aimed to reignite their brand with music, Music actually being a fairly integral part of music TV back in the 80s and 90s. And they might as well start with Beyonce's latest effort, her video for Lemonade. Roll it, boys!
They don't love you like I love you. Slow down, they don't love you like I love you. Back up, they don't love you like I love you. Step down, they don't love you like I love you.
They don't love you like I love you when you're cheating with another broad. You're kind of a jerk face. So let's talk about this a little bit. VH1, that's really how they reestablished themselves by creating series like Behind the Music and Storytellers. MTV is trying to do the same thing. It's not like they're going back to playing music videos 24 hours a day because people don't watch videos on TV. But they are employing Scooter Braun and Mark Burnett, who, you know, successfully brought down American Idol with The Voice. Will the strategy work?
I always wonder, what do young people think the M in MTV stands for?
They we know. Shown,
it doesn't stand for millennials.
We know.
It used to show, I remember, I'm so old, I remember when we used to say, I want my MTV.
Yeah.
And now I yell, turn down that music.
But then
and
you had to watch Duran Duran 19 hours a day.
That and Aldo Nova. I think it's going to show the real difference. They mentioned bringing back Unplugged.
Yeah.
And we're going to see what today's artists can do when they don't have auto-tune. Because back in my day, we worried about the artists screwing up because they were overdosing like real artists do.
No, that's absolutely right. But Unplugged was where you saw how talented a band really was.
Yes, they could really
do it. Play except completely stripped down. My Maserati. Hey. Okay, so Kat, no one's going to sit around during commercials to watch videos. Well, they could just pick up their phone and watch it on video.
Absolutely.
Is this an act of desperation like Ted Cruz and John Kasich colluding?
I guess, but I think MTV's crap is doing very well.
Okay.
You know, like the teen. When I had the flu, I watched so many episodes of 16 and Pregnant. Mm-hmm. They're all the same. It's like, first it's like, my mom says I can't do it. And then it's like, it turns out this is harder than I thought. And like, I watched that for hours. But you know what? You can't subsist off of crap alone.
Like, no, you can't.
I ate only Doritos one day and I felt terrible.
And then you got the flu.
Yeah,
or did you eat them during the flu?
I don't remember like that whole week.
Yeah. No,
so.
You got to admit though, you can't go too far wrong with Beyonce with a baseball bat.
No, I'm so sick of Beyonce.
That is gonna work.
I'm so sick of her. She's not even funny. Okay, she's not funny at all.
You've been oversaturated by Beyonce. You love her Grand Tetons. Now, Rick, you are a senior contributor at Forbes. Is this a good move, business move on MTV's part?
We'll find out. MTV, as you know, has been rudderless like since you were gone.
Exactly right.
It really has. They have.
I toot my own horn, but.
They don't know what to do with themselves, so why not try it? If there's a way to bring music back into it,
I've never been happy.
Well, you guys are fighting about Beyonce.
Anytime all the single ladies comes on a bar, it's
Bernie Sanders. I want to say thank you to Rick and Joe and Kat, Meow. Thank you all so much for being here. Welcome back, Rick. All right, coming up, Bernie Sanders isn't sure if cigarettes should be legal, but he has strong feelings about soda taxes. Professor Brian Brenberg breaks down the world nanny state sin taxes. And later, libertarian Kristen Tate joins me to summon millennials to the side of limited government. Will it work? Can she be convincing? You watch. You decide. Stay here.